What we have seen is about reference, sorry, tool geometry representation, different systems will be referred here. And a work reference system, that is WRSS, okay, WRS. So based on the job, okay, the second one is based on the tool, and the first one is based on the machine. Okay, so based on this machine specification, tool specification, and work specifications, these geometries are referred and represented. Okay, so a tool designation, ANSI or ASC, and an orthogonal rig system, how it is represented. You see, this is the representation of ASA, American Standard Association. You need to remember the sequence, otherwise in case you have the numerical, and if it is asked for more marks, for example, it is depend on, let's say there are sub questions, no, for example, one question is asked and then there are sub bits also inside it. So in that case, it is difficult to, you know, score. So better way you remember these lines, okay, sequence. Say alpha B is nothing but back rectangle. Alpha stands for the rectangle. Then alpha S is for side rectangle. Then theta E is nothing but end relief angle, okay, or end clearance angle. Then theta S is for side relief angle. Then CE is for end cutting edge angle. And CS is for side cutting edge angle, where R stands for the nose radius, which is in mm. Otherwise, all these six components are in degrees, okay, not in radian, degrees. Now, orthogonal rectangle, normally in numericals are asked based on these two systems, ORS. Now, ORS is where I stands for inclination angle, alpha is the rectangle, then gamma is the side relief angle here, gamma 1, it is nothing but the end relief angle, where C, again same end cutting edge angle, the lambda, it's one of the different component here, okay, in ORS. You need to see the different components here. So what are the different? First, it's starting with the inclination angle, okay. Inclination angle in case of orthogonal cutting, it is always zero. Like I said, inclination angle will be always, orthogonal cutting is at, it is happening at 90 degree, where cutting velocity is perpendicular to cutting edge, okay, and three components will be perpendicular, force components. See, the I will be zero in case of orthogonal cutting, where it has certain angle in oblique cutting, I, inclination angle. Then it is a side rake angle, directly side rake, no back rake and all, side rake angle. Then there is a side relief angle, then end relief angle or clearance, then end cutting edge angle, and now this one is approach angle, the lambda. Now normally it is 90 minus side cutting edge angle, 90 degree minus side cutting edge. So there is a relation, always remember there is a relation. Okay. Approach angle, where we have not seen in the geometry, 3D geometry, that we have seen a couple of minutes before. So there was not approach angle that I have not designated, but see, it is normally 90 degree minus side cutting edge angle. Okay, this one. Also, it is also called as a principal cutting edge angle. See, the principal cutting edge angle, that value is also sometimes given directly in the numerical. So you need to identify if principal cutting edge angle is given, then what is the system? It is ORS system. And then what is their rake angle in case of ORS system? Here, the second digit, okay, second sequence, second position will be rectangle, and nose radius is always in mm. Okay, so for a pure say orthogonal cutting, I is always a zero, and for oblique cutting, it is not zero. Okay, here is the say mistake. It is not zero. Oblique cutting, I is not. Now, we can have some conversion factor, some relation between the ASA and ORSA, so that you can get other angles also. So this is the conversion between the ASA and ORS. You need not to remember this, because in numericals, it will be given in simple straight way, in a simple way. straightforward review. However, you can remember this critical correlation. Now, what is critical correlation? It will be easy to understand what is given. Okay, so that way, when approach angle is 90 degree, okay, when approach in some numerical, let's say approach angle is 90 degrees given. So you need to understand approach angle is 90 degree means what? First thing is it is ORS system, okay, orthogonal rig system, ORS. And in that case, you have the side rig angle only, not the back rig angle, and that is equal to rig angle that you have to consider for the calculation. Okay, so with the help of rig angle, you know you can calculate the shear angle, okay, tan phi, that you know the equation. We'll see the ahead. So that is rig angle. Once you go to get the rig angle, you can go for the other you know calculations also. Then when inclination is zero, that means was a normal rig will be rig, okay, normal rig n, it is a rig, is equal to rig. Then when I is equal to 0 and lambda is equal to 90, the combination, then side rig is equal to normal rig is equal to rig. So that is the condition for the pure orthogonal cutting. Okay, and you know the what are this, what these symbols are signifying. Now in case of mechanism of chip formation in brittle material, okay, mechanism in case of chip formation in a brittle material and ductile material as well. Okay, so I have written here ductile material, but there has to be brittle material also. So here is the ductile material. Okay, this is for a ductile material, for ductile material, and this is for a brittle material. So what you can see here easily, that when cutting tool is interacting with the workpiece, then shear planes are okay. The chip is getting sheared in the planes, the stacks of the plane. You see the planes here. So these are the shear planes. It is getting sheared in the planes. Whereas that is not the condition with the brittle material. There are multiple fractures, minute, you know, cracks will be there, and then there is a major crack, so that the chip is getting suddenly broken, separated from this zone. Okay? No doubt it is a shear zone, but there is no yielding. Okay, no yielding, no deformation. That's why it is called brittle material, of course. So that is about the mechanism of the metal cutting in case of brittle and ductile metal. Types of chips, very known to you. So well known chip is continuous chip, then discontinuous chip, continuous chip with built up edge, without built up edge, and serrated chip. Okay, we'll see what is it. So types of chip depends on work material, whether it is ductile or the brittle. Then cutting tool geometry, the rig angle, what is the rig angle? Let's say positive, negative, zero. Then cutting angles, other cutting angles. Then cutting velocity and the feed, of course, the cutting parameters. These are called cutting parameters. Based on that, chips will be depending on. And then types of cutting fluid and method of application. Okay, so what kind of cutting fluid you use, and what is the type of application or method of application, that is also you know give you the different type of chip. Condition for forming discontinuous chip. Now discontinuous chips will not be long, right? It will be discontinuous, but when it will be forming, likewise. So material of irregular size and shape, if you have for machining, then there will be discontinuous chips. So work material will be brittle, for example gray cast iron, then there has to be discontinuous chip. Material of regular size and shape, that case the material may be ductile, but it is too hard and work hardenable, means uska hardening kya rahega. Okay, so hardening, that's one kind of heat treatment. So ductile material is there, but it is hardened. Okay, so in that case you say it is a regular size of and shape of material, but there will be discontinuous chips. Okay, never say if there is a ductile material, that means there is 100% continuous chips. No, you have to check the conditions. It is hard and work hardenable. And in that case, the what is the requirement? Say a feed should be large, then tool material will be tool rig will be negative. Okay, in that case you will get discontinuous chips, and cutting fluid will be inadequate. Okay, in some case you will not use the cutting fluid, and then surely you'll get the discontinuous chips. Condition for forming the continuous chips with out without a built-up age. Okay, now you, I have explained earlier what is the built-up age in the previous session. So built-up age is nothing but when the cutting, the cut chip is sliding over the rig surface because of the friction. It is anyway hot and it is getting welded on the rig surface, back rig surface, or the rig surface itself. Okay. And then it is getting welded again and again as the material chip is getting flowed towards the metal surface, or sorry, rig surface. Its size, sticking size or stuck size, it is going to increase, and it is going to decrease as well continuously. So that is nothing but the build-up age. And as it is in the action with the rig surface, having contact with the cutting the workpiece, it will damage the surface finish. Okay, so we don't want built-up age, but anyway you can control it. You cannot avoid it. Sometimes you cannot avoid it, but there are certain ways where you cannot, where you will not have the built-up age on the rig surface. So when you want a condition for forming the continuous chips without the built-up age, material should be ductile. The cutting velocity must be high. Feed should be low, rake angle will be positive and high, it is highly positive, okay. Then cutting fluid on both cooling and lubricating type, okay. Cutting fluid of both lubricating and cooling type. Condition for the forming continuous chips with built-up age now, okay. Earlier it was without built-up age, and you can see the comparison later. So work material is ductile anyway, and then cutting velocity is medium, there it was high. Then the feed, it is medium here. Cutting fluid absent or inadequate. See. So what is the effect of built-up age formation? The harmful, we'll see the harmful effect first. It unfavorably changes the rake angle at the tool tip, causing increase of the cutting force, and that way it is a higher power consumption. So higher power consumption because of the built-up age. Then it will induce the vibrations and the chatter will be there. It will, because of that, there will be poor surface finish. See, these are the interlinking factors. Okay, you need to study like that only. Then good, what are the good effects? Okay, good effects are also there. So built-up age protects the cutting edge of the tool. It will protect the cutting. Why? Because there will be contact with the built-up edge directly, not the sharp cutting edges of the tool, and that's why it is increasing the tool life. Because anyway, built-up edge, that built-up edge formation, that is producing and it is going away, it is generating and it is, you know, ceasing away. So it is continuous one, but because of that there is no or less interaction with the sharp cutting edge of the tool, and that's why it is increasing the life of the tool. Reduction or elimination of the built-up age. How? So, increase of the cutting speed. That way you are eliminating the built-up age. Then rake angle. You are increasing the rake angle. That way there will not be formation of built-up age. When you have ambient workpiece temperature. So, say that means less temperature. That then also you will not have, because there is no scope to melt up the chip and stucking to the rig surface. So ambient temperature. So that's why coolants are required. Okay. Then what you need to reduce in order to eliminate or reduce the built-up age? The feed you want to reduce. Okay. You need to reduce the feed. Then depth of cut you need to reduce. Cutting parameters except the cutting speed. See, the feed and depth of cut are the two cutting parameters. Those you need to reduce, where cutting speed you have to increase, one of the cutting parameters. Then the use of cutting fluid, these are the external parameter that is reducing the built-up age. And the change of cutting tool material, you can use thermits for non-formation or no formation of the built-up age. Okay, so this way you can reduce the or eliminate the built-up age formation. Serrated chip is something where you have seen the shear planes, right? Shear zones. That way the serrated chips looks like. There will be some steps. Okay. Serrated chips also called as a segmented or non-homogeneous chips that are that is a semi-continuous chip with zones of low and high strains. There is too much high strain, shear strain in the chip. Metals with low thermal conductivity and strength that decreases sharply with the temperature, such as titanium, exhibits this behavior. The chips have sawtooth like appearance. Okay, what you need to remember here is this: serrated chips are happening in case of titanium, where it shows the sawtooth like appearance. If you see the image on internet, you will clearly understand that, you can clearly distinguish between the different types of chips. So serrated is this saw like sawtooth like appearance. Okay? When is forced chips breaking is necessary and why? Okay, why you required to use a chip breakers? Okay, chip breakers. Why we need to use chip breakers? So that you will see now. Chip breakers, when chips continuously form and comes out very hot, sharp, and at quite high speed. In that case, we required chip breaker. In case of ductile material, you, in the workshop, you might have seen. Some chips are getting curled about the around the cutting tool itself, okay, or around the workpiece itself. And soon, in the interaction of the cutting tool and workpiece, those will be struck, and those are actually damaging the surface of the machine component, okay, or machine surface of the component. So that we don't want, okay. That is actually hampering the surface finish of the component, and that's why we require the chip breakers. Okay, so that is the reason. So under what condition you can use the chip breakers? Say soft ductile workpiece, if you have for machining, you are machining soft and ductile material, then in that case you want chip breakers. In some case where you have flat rake angles with positive or near 0 degree inclination, in that case also you require the chip breakers. No, you don't require chip breakers in case of negative rake angle. That is the inference from this important sentence. Okay, you are not going to use any kind of chip breaker in case of negative rake angle. It is required, very much required, in case of positive rake angle. And then why? Okay, why? In order to have safety and convenience of the operator, because those chips are actually getting wound around the tool and workpiece, and maybe that is a problematic to you operator as an operator. Easy collection and disposal of chip. Okay, so if it is getting wound, so it is very difficult to break them and then remove from the workpiece. So easy collection will be possible if you have chip breakers. Now, very important part that we are starting from here, it is the velocities in the metal cutting. Now I said in the figure I have shown there are three different velocities, right? So first one is a velocity, that cutting velocity V. Okay, velocity of tool relative to workpiece, that is the cutting velocity. Then velocity of the chip relative to work, in between a chip and the work. Okay, so rake surface. So Vs is the shear velocity. Okay, between chip, it is between chip and then work. That is shear velocity in the shear plane, and between. When there is an interaction between chip and rake surface, then it is called chip velocity. So three velocities: V, cutting velocity; Vs, shear velocity; and then there is a chip velocity. We'll see. So this is the the schematic representation of the cutting tool and cut chip, and then there is an uncut chip on this side. You see the V is the cutting speed, cutting velocity. Vc on this side, it is chip velocity, and Vs on this side, it is shear velocity. So if shear velocity and the shear plane, actually it is making inclination here 5 degree with the horizontal axis of the cutting machine surface. So this is a 5, and then there is a rake surface, and with the normal to the rake the machine surface, between that rake surface and normal, there is a alpha inclination rake angle. So these two rake angles are responsible to give you relation between the velocities. And what is it? So So these three components you are combining. These are three different velocity vectors that you are joining together. You will see velocity triangle, vector triangle here. And what you have here is the phi, okay, between Vs and Vc, okay, between Vs and Vc, you have phi, okay, shear angle. Then between Vc, okay, between Vc and this V, okay, and this V, you have another angle. This is 90 minus alpha, okay, 90 minus alpha. This is alpha here, and it is inclined like this. So you can see it is a 90 minus alpha. It is why 90 minus alpha, because say this is the rig surface. Can draw you for you. Okay. So this is rig surface, and in between this is alpha. Rig surface and normal alpha. So it is total 90. This is 90. So 90 minus alpha, this is the angle, 90 minus alpha. And based on that, you get another angle here. Okay, what is the angle? So this one. You know, addition of this triangle, it is 180 degree inclination. So here you have 90 minus alpha, here you have phi. So naturally it is becoming 90 minus phi minus alpha. Okay, this is the inclination. So based on the sine rule, okay, this is a sine rule. How you have employed it? So based on this, the opposite sides divided by angle, sine of that angle. So that is nothing but a side angle. That those are equal. So V, cutting velocity V divided by sine of 90, that is pi by 2 minus phi plus alpha, that is 1, is equal to shear velocity divided by a front angle. Okay, so that is nothing but the sine of pi by 2 minus alpha is equal to the cutting chip velocity, okay, chip velocity divided by sine of phi. Okay, now you know that from the trigonometry, sine of 90 minus something is equal to actually cos of that. Okay, that means what? Here it is phi minus alpha, that and that is cos of that is coming. Then sine pi by 2 minus alpha, that is equal to sine alpha. Understood? And then there is a Vc upon sine phi. So here what you can understand, let's say there is a chip thickness ratio that you know R is equal to if I write it here for you, I can write R is equal to chip thickness ratio, and that is equal to uncut chip thickness divided by chip thickness TC. So that is equal to Vc upon V. Here you can get Vc upon V is equal to what now? And that is equal to Vc upon V, if you take, that is equal to sine of bad handwriting. So sine of phi divided by cos of phi minus alpha. Okay, so this is the relation that you can get. Now, chip thickness, shear strain, and shear strain rate. These are important, you know, small concept and small formulae that you required in order to solve numerical based on the metal cutting and merchant theory as well. So, what is it? So, chip thickness is here. I'll read. Chip thickness is equal to T upon TC or T1 upon TC. T is uncut chip thickness, where TC is cut chip thickness. Always remember R is less than 1. Why? Because chip thickness TC is always greater than T. Okay, always greater than T. So this is less, this is higher. So always R is less than 1. Always remember. Okay. So that is equal to LC upon L. Okay. So length of the chip, cut chip divided by length of uncut chip. And that is also equal to VC upon V. Okay. VC upon V. And that is nothing but from that relation what we have seen. It is sine phi divided by cos phi minus alpha. And that is equal to 1 upon, this is here, K. 1 upon K. R is equal to basically 1 upon K. 1 upon K. And what is K? That is chip reduction. Chip reduction factor. Chip reduction factor. Okay, chip reduction function actor. Anyway, I'll not write. Okay, chief reduction factor. K is chief reduction factor. So R is equal to 1 upon K. In some numericals, chief reduction factor is given. So you need to understand what is the chief reduction factor and what is the chief ratio. Chief thickness ratio. Chief thickness ratio is R, where chief reduction factor is 1 upon K. Okay, or K is equal to 1 upon R. That way. And next you have tan phi. So what you do here, you just expand this. Phi, sine phi divided by cos phi minus alpha. So cos phi minus alpha, you have no mathematical formula here. Cos A minus B. So what is the formula there? Cos of phi, cos phi into sine phi. No. What is the formula here? What you have, cos A minus B, that is, that will be implicit as cos phi sine cos alpha plus sine phi sine alpha, right? So that you take and then you simplify, you equate with the R, what you get the relation. It is a simple work where you can get the relation for tan phi is equal to R cos alpha divided by 1 minus R sine alpha. You need to remember this. You once you get this, you can get this easily. Whether you remember or you can derive anyway, but it depends on how much time you have in an exam. Okay, so that way. So R is equal to sine phi upon cos phi minus alpha, where tan phi is equal to R cos alpha divided by 1 minus R sine alpha. So here phi you get, tan inverse of you do, then you get phi is equal to this. Okay, and what is that? That is a shear angle. Okay, from the rake angle, you got the shear angle. That's why I said initially, why the tool geometries are important and how those are represented. You need to remember the sequence. Where, when is the sequence of the rake angle? When is the sequence of clearance angle? So based on the ASA and ORS method of tool description. So phi shear angle will be obtained here based on the rake angle. And then there is the shear strain. Okay, shear strain. So that is nothing but the epsilon is equal to cot phi plus tan phi minus alpha. And if you simplify it, you get another relation, cos phi in terms of, you know, alpha, cos phi alpha divided by sine phi into cos phi minus alpha. What you need to do, cot means what? You do reverse cos phi divided by sine phi. And what about tan? So tan means what? Sine phi minus alpha divided by cos phi minus alpha. And then you try to simplify, you will get surely this equation. Okay, or you just remember this, cot phi plus tan phi minus alpha, that is nothing but the shear strain, but that is different than the shear strain rate. Okay, and what is shear strain rate? Is this, so epsilon dot, so change of strain with respect to time. And mathematically, with in the numerical, you can calculate as the shear velocity divided by thickness of shear zone. This is very important formula. You need to remember, though shear strain rate is equal to change in strain divided by with respect to time, though this is a formula theoretical, but in the numerical of the metal cutting, you need to use possibly this formula, shear velocity divided by thickness of shear zone. And thickness of shear zone means it is nothing but distance between two shear planes. Okay, so TS. So I hope you remember this. And then what you have is the cutting force vectors. Okay, and we are approaching to the merchant theory of the cutting forces. So what you have, this is the cutting mechanism that we have observed initially. And remember, there are different interactions. Okay, there are different interactions. First, you will understand, let's say this, you observe this right side figure. When cutting tool is in contact with the chip, workpiece, then the plowing action starts. Plowing action. Initially, there is no shearing. There is a plowing. Okay, plowing means the way farmer does. Okay, so that is a plowing. And in that case, you will see two important cutting forces acting on the cutting tool. Okay, one is this. This is cutting force. FC, okay, and normal to that, there is one cutting force. This is is also called thrust force or feed force. You got it? So this is a cutting force, actual cutting force, and normal to that there is a feed force or the thrust force. Remember this. Okay. I will try to make you understand in the best possible manner so that you will not forget it later. Say, try to remember this. When there is a cutting action, okay, when there is a cutting action, so cutting forces will be experienced by the cutting tool is FC and FT. FC is the cutting force in the direction of cutting velocity, and where FT is the thrust force or the feed force normal to the cutting cutting force, okay, FC. So why this? Because you know, so you have these two forces, and then there will be resultant, okay, there will be resultant like this. This is a resultant for this two, okay, R. This is, let's say, R dash. Understood? Now this is one kind of action. Now the second action is here. If you see, second kind of action is between chip, okay, and then tool, okay, chip and tool, where cutting tool, cutting chip is flowing like this with the chip velocity. So what is this? Chip velocity BC. Chip velocity BC. And then it is the friction, okay, there is the friction. So what you have here, so between this interaction you will get the different forces, vectors. And which are the vectors? Say this one is friction, frictional vector F, friction force, and normal to the friction force, these two. And there is a result, as those are there perpendicular to each other, there is a always resultant, and that resultant you can call R double prime, okay, R prime and R double prime, okay, R double dash. That is it. So this is another force vector. This is interaction between chip and tool. Now there is an interaction between the workpiece itself and then chip. Okay, chip is getting separated from the workpiece. Why? Because there is a shear plane. Okay, there is a shear plane, and when there is a shear plane, what you do? There is a shear force along the shear plane like this, and then there is a normal force to the shear plane, shear force, that is Fn, normal force to the Fs. This is the Fs, and there is a resultant, and this is you represent as R dash. So what do you do? These are the force vectors. Free body diagram, if you see those vectors, you can resolve like this, and then R3, R2 and R prime, R1, that you are superimposing. Okay, so you are trying to superimpose ek ke upar ek rakhna hai. Okay, so that way you just superimpose, and you know, surprisingly what you get is the common resultant. And if you you know, divide that resultant, okay, you divide that resultant here and try to draw a circle, you will get the merchant circle. Understood? So this is about the merchant circle. It's very easy to understand. So what you need to remember here always, that when there is a cutting tool is in contact with the workpiece, there are two forces coming. One is cutting force like this, and then normal to that there is a feed force or the thrust force. And the resultant is always there. Okay, so this two. Then there is a cutting, there is a friction action between cutting tool and chip. Okay, chip is sliding over the cutting tool surface, so there is a friction force like this here. Tool is moving like this, so friction force is acting like this. So there is a friction force, and normal to the friction force is N, and then based on that you have resultant. So the inclination made here, I forgot to tell, it is a beta friction angle. It is a friction angle. Okay. Then there is a interaction between chip and workpiece. Why? Because there is a relative motion, some kind of relative motion between the chip and workpiece. Workpiece is still there, but chip is getting removed. It is getting separated from the workpiece. So there is a relative motion, and as there is a relative motion, there will be formation of forces in case of free body diagram. So you have, this is a shear force in the shear plane, and normal to that there is a friction. Normal force to the shear plane, and then resultant. So this resultant, that is equal to this and this, and then you superimpose actually, and then you will get the cutting. हेलो।
हेलो सर,
हाँ यस,
सर रिपीट कर दगा पुढच्या लेक्चरला.
इट्स व्हाट इज हैपनिंग, इट्स टू मच फॉर यू?
नो मीन्स आई एम ओनली इन द लेक्चर नाउ, ऑल हैव लेफ्ट. मीन्स आई हैव अंडरस्टैंड अदर थिंग बट दिस ओनली.
See, I think most of the okay, very least part is remain. We'll complete it, no issue.
Okay,
We'll complete it. Very least part is remain. I need not to see already a few slides I missed to record, but we'll complete it now.
Okay.
You got it? What is the how much a circle is derived?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is about the complete. This is the merchant circle. Okay, merchant force circle diagram. So you have this. Three force vectors superimposed, and you got the shear force with the phi, then FT, thrust force, then friction force, then normal force. Here is the beta friction angle. This is a rake angle, and as there is a rake angle here, and this total is 90 degree. Okay, this total is 90 degree. So you have this 90 minus alpha, and then. You have here finally left 90 minus that, so total angle is beta minus alpha. So what are the assumptions for the metal cutting? Say tool work, the work material behaves like idle plastic. Then theory involves as a metal minimum cut energy principle. Then tau and beta, tau means shear stress and beta are assumed to be constant. And that is independent of the phi shear force. Then it is based on the single shear plane theory. Okay. Then from the merchant circle, you can derive this formulae. You need not to remember or mug, but you can derive it simply, or you just remember the circle, the force vectors, you can calculate easily. So tan beta is the friction angle you can get from F divided by N. Mu is the friction angle. Friction factor. So mu tan beta is equal to Ft plus Fc tan alpha divided by Fc minus Ft tan alpha. Shear area that is equal to uncut chip thickness. Here it is uncut chip thickness T1 into W divided by sine phi. Then tau is equal to Fs upon As. Okay, that is actually shear. Shear strength, so for shear force divided by shear area, and you get this equation Fs into sin phi divided by width into uncut chip. And then normal stress is equal to normal force to the shear force divided by shear area, so Fn into sin phi divided by width into. Limitations of the merchant theory. Merchant theory is valid only for orthogonal cutting. Then by ratio of force by N, the merchant theory gives apparent but not actual coefficient of friction. So that is the biggest disadvantage of the merchant theory, merchant circle. The shear angle adjusts itself so that cutting force is minimum. That is the one of the key point one should learn in the merchant theory. So here we need to reduce the, we need to keep the cutting forces minimum. And so in every possible way, if you are minimizing the energy, so you get this relation phi shear force that is equal to the 45 degree inclination plus alpha by 2 minus beta by 2. Okay, that is in degree, where you have in case of radian, CA, the actually pi by 4 it comes then, and then 0.785 plus alpha by 2 minus beta by 2. Okay, that is in radian. Then based on theory of Lee and Schaefer, when it is a plasticity theory of plasticity, in case you can consider idle rigid plastic material and you use it, they also assume that deformation occurred on the thin shear plane. There is very thin shear plane. In that case, you have phi is equal to pi by 4 plus alpha minus beta. okay, there is a difference between merchant, and here it is alpha by 2 and beta by 2. It was there, but here it is alpha minus beta. Okay? And then with the stabler, you have pi by 4, same, plus alpha by 2, it is there, but it's not beta by 2, it is beta compared to, you know, merchant center. That you need to remember, because in this some cases, you will be asked to use this equations in order to decide the shear angle. The determination of the uncut deformed chip thickness in turning, you need to remember this formula. I'll be taking some exam, a test, maybe tomorrow or day after tomorrow. So you need to prepare or remember this formula. So that is single point cutting tool. T is equal to feed into a sine lambda approach angle. And then B is equal to depth of cut divided by sine lambda. Where T is uncut chip thickness, F is the feed, lambda is the approach angle, 90 minus side cutting edge angle, and side cutting angle, that you know what is the value of it. So the specific cutting energy is the total energy per unit volume of the material removed. Okay, so it is always dissipated in terms of friction and shearing. So UT is the total specific energy, that is equal to frictional specific energy plus shear specific energy, okay, or specific energy in the shear. Specific energy, that is total only, energy divided by volume, and energy in terms of joule, where volume you can measure in terms of meter cube, centimeter cube, or mm cube. Then specific energy, when you have a rate to calculate, so it is power divided by volume rate. So power in terms of joule per second, and volume rate in terms of, again, meter cube per second, mm cube per second, or centimeter cube per second. Where power is always, you remember, it is force, cutting force into velocity, cutting velocity, Fc into V. V is the cutting velocity, Fc is the cutting force, Fc. Then volume of material remove rate, that is MRR, it is equal to uncut chip thickness, T1 into W into the V, okay, width into velocity, cutting velocity. So the total, the specific energy, then it is becoming PCA upon R, that is total power divided by volume rate, material removal rate. So power is Fc into V divided by V. Here it is, you can see it is a T0. It's T0, okay? It's not 2. It's T0, or uncut chip thickness T1 only, you can see. So this is nothing but your, say, total specific energy. So finally you got Fc upon uncut chip thickness into width, that is the total specific cutting energy. So in that case, you can get this formula, power for in the friction, specific cutting energy in the friction, when chip velocity Vc, you get F into Vc divided by V into T1 or T0 into W. T0 and T1 here, same we are taking. Okay? This is uncut chip thickness. Then specific cutting energy in the shearing, that you have when Vs is equal to shear velocity. So Fs, shear force that you take. Okay. And then into here, the points to remember. Okay. So this is here friction force. Okay. This is friction force, and this is the shear force. This is shear force. Always remember. Why? Because we want to find out the specific energy in shearing, and we want to find out the specific energy in friction. When you want to find out specific energy, total specific energy, we need to use the cutting force, and then into velocity, is the cutting velocity divided by, say, V, cutting velocity, into uncut chip thickness into width of cut. Okay, so that is about units. Now unit of specific energy are typically in newton meter per mm cube or joule per mm cube, and unit of U is generally joule per mm cube. Okay, so these are the references for the this topic, and I'll see you in the next lecture. Okay, I'll see you in the next.